Hello and welcome to the Big Bucks PC Gamers Hangout for, what is today, May the 31st. Our topics for today are, which was the best game company ever? That's a big topic. And our show and tell topic for today is our favorite game of all time. So we got lots of favorites today. I guess we'll start with the show and tell topic of our favorite game of all time. Who would like to go first?
Well, as is usually my role to fill awkward silences, I'll go first. I've actually got a selection of favorites, so you'll have to bear with me because each of them has a probably tedious anecdote associated with it. And I'm trying to try and not repeat too much stuff that I've shown in previous sessions. This is The Colonel's Bequest. It was the first of the Laura Bow mysteries. It was an absolutely jam-packed title. Full of discs. Well, that went well. And it had really awesome copy protection. Made it one of my favourites was that it was one of the first adventure games that I completed and played. And the fact that it was very narrative and had that and had the time and had the sort of time and chapter based components and so on really made it a really significant part of my game and my personal gaming history. That's the first of mine. I've got a couple more, but I need to pick up these bits of boxes. So if someone else would like to pick up from here.
Okay, I'll jump in real quick. I had a hard time deciding, but I eventually settled on two games that to me are about equal. Number one was Curse of the Azure Bonds, which I have to say I spent hours and hours on this game when I was younger. Of the Gold Box series, this one is probably the best of all of them. And this here is my original copy from when I was younger. It was survived the move, the ill-fated move. It's complete in there, and it's just probably one of the best examples of the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons rule set implemented into a computer game of all time, the first edition. I think this was first edition. This has to be first edition. Yeah, first edition of the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons rules. The other one was Out of the Beholder, which was has got to be equally favorite of mine, which is a similar game, but I think we all know about this one. This also is my original copy. And I think I've showed this before, but I'm going to show it again for anyone who wasn't around or didn't see it. But this particular copy has original drawn maps of all the levels from little young Joel, who drew all these maps on the old graph paper there. Wow. Yeah, and I've got every level in the game still mapped out in here, so you could play through the whole game with these things. But those are my two of my favorite games for the PC.
If I could ding back in quickly. My official favorite game of all time is Ultima 6. I know it's a somewhat controversial choice as far as Ultimas go, but again, it's my favorite for very personal reasons. To this day, when I play an Ultima game, I have this, my original Orb of the Moons, like right in front of me. A small part of me is convinced that one day I will just stare outside the window and there will be a moon gate. That is sort of how much this game has impressed itself in my memory, and I think it was the game that actually really got me into CRPGs, which is it's probably the genre I play more than anything else. Although I'm a great fan of adventure and strategy games, and you know, stuff involving blowing things up messily. And from there I ended up going through a raft of games, going through a period where I didn't game for a while. And then, when I was getting back into computing via Linux, I discovered Neverwinter Nights, not the original Neverwinter Nights, but the 2004 Neverwinter Nights, which was one of the early games that you could actually get running properly under Linux, with no more than a week's worth of configuration. it was kind of the dark ages of Linux distros back then. And from there, I went from having not gamed for certainly two or three years to playing Neverwinter Nights obsessively. And then I got seriously back into gaming, which is how I got into Oblivion. This is not a big box. I am so disappointed that this is not a big box. I am offended at the lack of a big box release of Oblivion. If someone told me there was one, I will give you all the things to give it to me. Which I think sort of neatly brings us to Bethesda's very well-justified dominance of the modern CRPG scene and returns to the open worlds of the sort that we saw in Ultima 6. So that's me.
I'll show you something that'll make you jealous. This is my Oblivion Collector's Edition.
It has a sleeve?
I'm just showing this to make you feel bad.
Is it all sleevey?
Let's see. Yep, opens up like that.
Very pretty. I probably should get one of those. That's very nice artwork. I haven't seen them anymore, but
they're pretty available.
I wonder if the European release was ever put out like that, because we sort of didn't have very much of that sort of small box era, although we did go to sleeves quite quick. We did have sleeves for quite a long time. That's a very nice addition. It's a good game.
Yeah, I don't know if Elder Scrolls Anthology would count as that or not. Have you looked into that?
Elder Scrolls what?
Oh, the new one that came out?
Yeah, the Anthology.
Yeah.
The price keeps dropping in the stores, so I'm going to pick one up eventually because they can't seem to be able to sell them around here.
Right. Does anyone else have a thing to show? I know Joe does.
It's definitely my turn now. All right. Sorry, Pascal. You want to go? All right. It's me. How's everybody doing? Has to be my favorite. Out of all of them, I can't help it. Wing Commander 4, this has got to be, without question, my favorite game of all time. It is cutting edge. They moved forward with every single advancement from full motion video to music to increasing the gameplay. It was all there. They had everything. But most importantly, what I wanted to show more than anything is I have to take it over the top. This is actually a relic. This is a helmet from the actual game from Wing Commander 4. This is a Black Lance helmet. This was worn by one of the actors in the full motion video sequences. So they were the big evil bad guys in the game because we had killed all the Kilrathi by then. So that was mine for today.
You know, Joe, whenever I was at Dragon Con, Malcolm McDowell was there. I said, I got his autograph and his first lady figure. And I said, Malcolm, I bet you the only person here who's most excited to see you because of Wing Commander. And he said, oh, yeah, Admiral Tallwin. He actually remembered, you know, the characters and everything. And he said, you'd be surprised how many people are here because of Wing Commander. Apparently, I was not the only one.
That's incredibly cool. I'm so glad that that wasn't just a simple bit part for him. He got to do a death scene. He was happy about that. Oh, 20-year-old spoiler.
Oh, Pascal, I knew you'd have this. This is the reason I didn't bring Gabriel Knight, because I was fairly certain that Pascal would.
Yeah, talking about Mark Hamill, what I have like best games of each genre, and talking about adventure games, it is definitely, without doubt, Gabriel Knight 1, Sins of the Fathers, best adventure game.
It's an astonishingly good game.
Mark Hamill is in that as well. He is a voice actor for Detective Mosley, besides the amazing Tim Curry, who is doing the voices of Gabriel Knight himself. So this game by story and design, I guess, by Jane Jensen, this is so awesome. That's, in my opinion, a masterpiece, one of my most favorite adventure games of all time, plus one of the most amazing boxes of all time. I like this Gabriel Knight box. This is one of the three not regular-shaped boxes Sierra ever released, and I'm happy they choose Gabriel Knight for that one as well. So this is just great. I like the story. I like the fantasy setting they put into the story. I like the puzzles, even though if you die like 100 million times, but it's awesome. It has nice music, nice story, nice gameplay. So what else is there you ever want more? That is the best game ever created. If you haven't played it, play it. 20th year's anniversary is 20 years, 25 years, I don't know. It was released in 93, so it should be like 22 years anniversary edition released. So choose whatever. This one is playable as well, so definitely go by and try that one. Best ever. That's my
first one. I think the voice acting, I actually quite liked the anniversary remake, but the voice acting in particular sets the first one apart. I mean, it's some of the best voice acting, not just of its era, but of any adventure game title I can think of, in my opinion.
Right, agree. That is the other box. That is the regular one, or the more common one, which you can easily still find today. So it's another awesome box design. I think nice colors, nice setting the atmosphere in the right mood, I guess. You get an impression of what's going on. And I really like it. It's all about voodoo and really, really nice. So Jane really digs deep into all this voodoo stuff and topics. So that is really a nice one.
Beautiful. I think Douglas said he wanted to go next, but he's off screen right now. Someone vamp frantically. Yeah, Joe, dance number.
Jazz hands.
Here's a little picture that I did for Jane. I'm not sure if it ever ended up getting into the remake special edition features, but this is part of a project that I'm working on for Jane, which is her book for her Kickstarter rewards. And this is... just a little sneak preview of that.
That's awesome.
Nice.
That is beautiful.
Thank you for that.
All right. Anybody else got their favorite game of all time to show before we move on to our next topic?
Just have a question if no one is... rushing for the next show and tell. And Brandon, do we have original art of Gabriel Knight in the archive and the project? I saw some back, I guess, years ago or so, someone selling a lot of original sketches and arts of Gabriel Knight 1.
There was quite a lot scanned for the re-release game. What one of the nice things they did was in each scene, they embedded a sort of historical element, and you could open once you've been to a screen, you could click through, and you could see illustrations of the work in progress for the scene, some outtakes, the new artwork, the old artwork, and lots of people's experiences of it. And I know there was some artwork captured for that.
I have no comment about that at this time, but Pascal, I can tell you a few things privately later.
Okie dokie.
Are you really going to leave a teaser like that just laying out there in the middle of the floor?
Yeah, I am.
You're a bad person.
I want to know, too.
Right, we don't appear to have a Douglas at the moment.
I guess this is a good spot to transition into the very best game company ever. for such a short amount of time that games have been a thing, which I would say about 40 years, I guess, Correct me if I'm wrong on that number, because I just pulled that out of my rear end. There have been a lot of hot flashes, for sure. If I personally had to pick, and I thought about this all day, if I had to pick my very favorite game company ever, and Pascal's going to love this one, I'd have to go with Blizzard Entertainment, probably, because, I mean, if you just look at games that I spent the very most amount of time on, Blizzard games that have to be the ones. World of Warcraft, I've been playing since launch, pretty fairly consistently. Diablo, I don't even want to think about how much my grades suffered in college because of that damn game. I played that game incessantly. Warcraft 2, me and a friend of mine, Ryan, played that game over modem in town, drove my parents crazy because we could never get phone calls because we were playing Warcraft 2 over modem all the time. Warcraft 3, I mean, really, Blizzard's library is fairly small, but every game they come out with is of exceptional quality, even though, and they're not really trailblazers as far as innovation either. They're more of a take an established genre and just refine it down and make it, you know, just super quality. I'm going to have to go with Blizzard, I think. So what do you guys got?
We're actually trying to get to the bottom of what this one isn't about personal preference. This is about objective truth by gods.
We're going to have a hard time coming to a consensus on that, I'm afraid.
We really will. However, what we've got here is there are a few obvious candidates. I mean, I'm going to throw my hat with Joe here, because I'm going to go with Origin as my sort of nominee for best company ever. But if you think about it, it's incredibly hard because there are many ways you can look at what was the best company, not just in terms of quality of games, although that's obviously critical, but in terms of treatment of fans. For example, I mean, particularly recently, although EA have a reputation as a small company swallowing monster of doom, their relationship with fans, particularly over issues like for example the kind of let's say progressive content included in the Dragon Age games, they took a lot of flack for having sort of visible gay relationships in their games, for example, and they went out there and they said, sorry, this is what we're doing, and that's actually a lot of support for the developer's vision in the face of internet populism. So that kind of integrity aspect could be important, or perhaps the way a company treats its employees, which I doubt EA would win any prizes for, particularly given the recent close down of Maxis. So there are many aspects, but ultimately, I'm going with Origin because they did a lot to sort of bring up narrative voices from within the company. I mean, it did have its superstars, and it was sort of very top-down led in many ways. But the games they created and the culture they fostered in their fan base. I mean, you will find few more rabid groups of fans than Origin fans, and the culture that goes with what Origin and to a large extent Richard Garriott stand for. In gaming is, I think, quite characteristic of their work. So, Origin, I suppose I'd count Portalarium as a continuation of Origin as well. So, that's me.
I don't know. I mean, as I said on Facebook before, it really is about how do we want to define what is the best company on there. As you said, Kate, there are so many aspects. The most companies I weight from back then. I only know the games of them. I was too young to think of other things like, do they treat their employees well? I care about that today because I'm an employee today, so I care how companies treat their employees. Back then, I was just young and played games. So the best companies for me back then when I chose were, of course, companies that produced games that I enjoyed most. And as the ones who know me know, I was always in first-person shooters and in adventure games, and so it's always, it comes down to its software. If we talk about Doom, it comes down, of course, to Sierra. If we talk about all the adventure games they made, it comes to LucasArts. So there's so many companies which I easily can choose just by saying, hey, they produced so many great games. Not all of them were great, but they had a lot of great games I enjoyed a lot, so they are definitely one of the best companies I would put on my top best company ever list. But if I have to choose one, and I can't disappoint Stuart here, it is, of course, Sierra. Not only why I'm a huge fan, why I am a huge fan, it is just because they did not only so many things for gaming. We had a Sierra special last time. They did so many things new, like first graphic adventure game, first graphic adventure game in color, first game or one of the first games with a female protagonist in a game, first one of the first company with an adult themed game, so many successful adventure game titles. But besides all these games, they did so much more. They had so many influence on developing sound standards. They had, like, later they go into the Sierra Network thing and were one of the first companies doing, like, having online possibilities to connecting players or people to do gaming and other chat stuff like chatting or so. So if I take all that in consideration, I definitely would go by Sierra, of course. I think they are one of the best companies ever. And I would like to judge it from a point of view like how a company influenced gaming industry in total, not only going down to games. Now, I have so many other companies. If we talk about games and adventure games in particular, we have so many: Lucasfilm, Legend Entertainment, Westwood, so much more. Revolution Software, Baphomet Sword, Seaverse, and so on. But they were very good games, and I enjoyed them a lot. But from a company perspective, on companies who did a lot for the gaming industry in total, I think Sierra did a pretty much good job there, as far as I can judge it. But maybe we get some internals from one of our guys who are with us.
I think that sums it up perfectly, Pascal. Although you're wrong. I have to go with KG. I mean, I think that she was onto something there. I'm really not sure, but I think she made some really good points, and I'm going to pass, considering that everyone already realizes what I'm probably going to say. So I think KG already said it all.
I think Sierra's a good mic. Is a good one to have in the running. The only complaint I could ever levy against Origin would have to be the infamous Electronic Arts buyout. And if you ask Richard Garriott today if he thought that was a good idea, he would tell you that it was, because he's explained many times why selling out to Electronic Arts was a good idea. I don't think there's any doubt that the quality of the games they were producing suffered once Electronic Arts got on the scene. The Ultima series specifically, which was their flagship series. But, Blizzard had a similar situation where they were bought out by Activision, which you could levy about the same complaint with them, but I don't think that the quality of their work necessarily suffered under Activision, and they did just recently buy themselves back, so they're no longer owned, so that at least they got off from under that thumb. But we'll see if that turns out to have been a good or a bad idea in the future.
As we have already talked about in the forums and in Facebook and things like that, while you are correct, Joel, with the Eater of Worlds, you know, the EA flag that was going on, first of all, they've changed their reputation, and they have been nothing but awesome to the fans. But what a lot of people don't realize is that all that stuff was going down a lot earlier than people thought. Everybody says 92, 93 is when EA ended up buying Origin. They had a vested interest in Origin in 1990. So that means that if Garriott did not sell out, there would be no Wing Commander. There would be no Ultima 7, no Serpent Isle, no Crusader. I mean, these are series that literally have become, you know, de facto standards in comparison to newer games. Everybody's still comparing stuff to Ultima 7 to this day. What was that? That was 1992. Count on your fingers. You know? And people are still comparing it to, if EA hadn't bought them, there would be no Ultima 7. So you got to give them that. I mean, Origin would have went under in 1991 if EA had not gotten involved.
How does that, how shockingly EA positive we are, we're being as a group so far? I mean, I've just praised their integrity earlier, and so good for us for not going with the cliches.
This commercial was brought to you by Electronic Arts. EA Sports, it's in the game.
I don't mind Electronic Arts necessarily. I play their games quite often and enjoy them, and you know, I don't have any vitriol towards them necessarily.
Wasn't that you earlier? I will never play another EA game again, ever. Isn't that you that always post that?
No, that's not me. I will say in Origins, in the plus column for Origin, they did essentially invent the massive multiplayer genre, even though there were games that came out before it. For all practices and purposes, Origin invented the massive multiplayer genre. And Ultima Online had a feature list that MMOs to this day haven't been able to touch, as far as like sailing ships, ownership of houses and stuff. And
you could interact with everything. It was very much like walking into Ultima 7 when I got onto UO for the first time, which was a bit after the Americans because I was in Europe. I'm in Europe, but yeah, you could interact with everything. And that's still something I feel... I mean, you have a complex crafting system in a lot of MMOs, but you could interact with more pointless things that in UO than you can... I mean, usually when you can interact with something, there's a reason for you to be able to interact with it. Ultima Online and also the Ultimas that preceded it. Yeah, there was no point to being able to do this. You could just do it because it was part of the world.
One bit I'll give to Sierra, just to give some backup to Pascal, is that I don't think any company in the history of computer games did more to bring people to the platform than Sierra did. And what I mean by that is at the time, I guess Sierra hit their stride in the late 80s, really, which would have been around the time Nintendo was a hot item. The earlier games would have been competing with, I guess, the end of the Atari age. Well, so console gaming has always been this kind of cloud around the gaming scene, and Sierra really legitimized the IBM PC as a gaming platform, which probably did more for the industry than any other game company that I can think of. It is a good segue, I guess. Pascal, I guess I should turn this over to you. You want to introduce Josh and get us rolling on that.
Hello, it's Joel.
Pascal?
Say again. I missed the...
Would you like to bring in an intro to Josh, please, at this point?
Yeah, actually, that is a good point to jump in here. And thanks for my setup falling down right now. I would ask Josh a question about the Sierra thing, and so I guess it's a good time to introduce him. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud to have Josh Mandel with us tonight. He agreed to join us, and maybe give us some internals about Sierra, what he did back then. And there's a question I have, Josh. When did you join Sierra? I guess it was beginning of the 90s, but you will correct me that second, I guess. But the question I have with that, and talking about the best company or so, did you already know about that time what Sierra is like company-wise? Did you have an understanding so far? So how did you get in contact with Sierra? What was your opinion about Sierra? And does it mean anything back then already, or does it develop while you were joining them?
Well, I started at Sierra in 1990. April of 1990, and I was already a huge fan of Sierra. Actually, I would be hard pressed to think of a game company that I wasn't a fan of. I mean, I played all the SSI, the Gold Box games. I loved Ultima 3. I probably spent a year with Ultima 3, and another one with Ultima 4. But I was a enormous fan of Sierra, and I remember. At the time, I had a job in an ad agency. I would do copywriting during the day and comedy at night. And I remember when Space Quest 3 was about ready to come out. And every day, I would walk the half mile from work to, I think it was a Babbage's, to see if Space Quest 3 had come in yet. And every day, you know, they knew me at the store, and they would say, you know, they'd see me walk in the door, and they'd say, nope, not today, maybe tomorrow, maybe Tuesday. So, yeah, I was a huge fan, and the way I got caught up with the company was that I'd been beta testing, and I beta tested for Infocom. I actually beta tested a little bit for Surtech, which hasn't been mentioned very much in the years since it passed, and I wanted to beta test for Sierra too, because A, I didn't want to have to pay for the games, and two, I wanted to get them before anyone else got them, and three, I wanted to see if I could have a little bit of influence on the way they turned out. So I was hot and heavy into CompuServe at the time, and I was a sysop. There's an antiquated term for you. I was a sysop on their gamers forum and their game publishers, or they called it game vendors forum, and so on. And then one of the other sysops said, yeah, there's this guy in the gamers forum, Garuka. You know Garuka, and I'm like, yeah, I know Garuka. She said, well, Garuka works for Sierra Online. He's a producer there. So I asked him if maybe they could use me as a beta tester, and he said yes, and then it all derived from that.
Very cool. You said you beta tested for Surtech? What games did you test?
I tested one game for them, and it was a text adventure, and I don't remember the name of it, but they put out a text adventure. I wish I remembered the name.
That I'm is sure nice
you, to me. I'm sure you could find it on Moby Games.
And I'm sure two or three of us are running there now.
So how did you move from... from beta testing to being more involved in the production of the games? How did you make that jump?
Well, I really threw myself into the beta testing like crazy. I mean, I approached it as if it was my full-time job, and I would write out very detailed reports. I kept each entry in the beta test log to exactly what they wanted to know, and not a lot of extra fluff. And I got my reports in fast. And one of, I think, the big turning points was when I beta tested Codename Iceman, a game perhaps about the least said the better. But I had encountered a crash bug in Codename Iceman, and I was living in Chicago at the time, and I reported on this crash bug, and they kept asking me questions about it, and I kept trying to help them duplicate it, and they could never duplicate it. Finally, one day, I get this call from a guy named Mark Hood, who I didn't know at the time, but he was big at Sierra. And he said, all right, the only way we're going to determine this crash bug is to get you to play the game with us from the start until you encounter it. And it took, Codename Iceman was a difficult game to get. Oh, yes. It was a really difficult, thank you, Pascal. It was a really difficult game to get through. So it took maybe 5 or 6 hours to get to the point in the game where I was getting that crash bug. And I was on the phone with Mark Hood telling him everything I was doing, you know, everything I was typing in and every place I was walking. And then finally, after 5 or 6 hours, I got the crash bug. And I said, there. And he said, oh, I got it. And so that was a golden moment in my young life. And so eventually, after maybe about a year and a half of beta testing, Garuka called me and he said, you know, I am the producer for every game that we're putting out, and we've got more than a dozen games in the pipeline, and I'm producing all of them, and it's too much for me. Would you be interested in coming here and being a junior producer for us? And at first I thought, there is no way I'm moving out to the middle of nowhere in California where I know nobody, would take a big pay cut, wouldn't be able to do comedy anymore or anything, to be a producer, which I really didn't have any interest in being a producer. But then I went out there for the interview, and I saw what Corey and Laurie were doing on the next Quest for Glory, and I saw what Mark Crow and Scott Murphy were doing on Space Quest 4, and I saw King's Quest 5 in production, and I was so blown away with everything about the company. Ken, who was so friendly, Ken, When I drove up to the building, Ken came out of the building to meet me and shake my hand, and I didn't even recognize him at first. I was just so blown away by everything, by the company, by Oakhurst and the Yosemite area, which I had never been to, the people in the town. By the time the interview was over and I went back to Chicago, I thought, well, I'm taking this job. And maybe it will advance from junior producer to something in the writing or design area, because that's what I really wanted to do.
But does being a producer, a junior producer, mean you have to know development skills like programming and so? And if yes, where did you have? No,
I had no programming skills at all. I didn't know. The last programming I had done was in high school, doing little basic routines. No, being a producer meant more like being a go-between between the main office, you know, Ken and the bean counters, and the creative people, and making sure that the game was on schedule and on budget and all those tasks that I was not set up for, had never done, knew nothing about, and really didn't have any interest in.
Nice.
So what were the first titles you got to take that particularly thankless role on? I'm looking at a cheat sheet now, and I can see that you were involved in one of the Thexter games as a producer, which I presume can't have been, although I personally enjoy Thexter games, it can't have been a particularly prestigious role, I assume.
No, the working on the Japanese games was a whole other area that was very difficult for me, because I had to interface with the game arts people in Japan, and there are a lot of rules and customs around dealing with business in Japan, and I didn't know any of them, you know, and I had to call them sometimes at 4 in the morning, so I wasn't really awake. So yeah, Thexter 2, but really the first project that they handed me when I walked in the door was the remake of King's Quest I. That was the very first project they told me about. And Thexter 2 came a little bit later.
Oh, I hope we lose it. Oh, man, that stinks.
Let's hope we can get back.
I'm on a train.
Tor's called somehow.
Yeah, F Joe.
While we're waiting for Josh to come back, I'll pop in here briefly. And for the argument for Sierra, here is something that I think says it all in terms of the way that they promoted their games, the way that they interacted with their customers, their in-house magazine for their customers was just something really incredible, really special. And it's not just like a little thing that a little pamphlet that was in their box, and they had plenty of catalogs and pamphlets in their box, but this was, you know, a full thick publication, and it just kept coming and coming and coming. It wasn't like a one-time thing.
Yeah, Joel, I think you had almost all those issues, didn't you?
I had some of those interaction magazines. I'm not sure where they ended up at. I probably threw them away. Like, everything else is cool.
I for sure threw mine away. I mean, the problem with those magazines, though they were great, was they were definitely like a shill for Sierra. There was nothing independent about them at all. They just shilled every single possible thing they could shill. So after I read them, I enjoyed them. I disposed of them, but, you know, I guess today I wish I still had them.
They did actually, they republished a lot of articles from other magazines, whether it was reviews or interviews. So that was something that, I mean, obviously they published favorable things, but you know, I mean, it was their magazine. And there was a lot of, there was a lot of really cool behind-the-scenes stuff that was published in those magazines. So that was something that made them really great.
I agree. So while we wait for Josh to come back, can I say what I think the best game developer or company of all time is?
No.
All right, I'm all done.
Josh, are you back?
I think I am. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, you can hear me. For some reason, it dropped out. I don't know where I was when it dropped out, but I want to hear what Stuart's favorite company is.
Thanks, Josh.
Hi, Stuart.
Hey, Josh. How's it going?
Okay.
So I'm gonna train in a rainstorm, so if I get cut off, then that's the reason why. But I had two picks, actually. The first one I wanted to say was, for me, a more obvious pick, which is Legend. And I'm not going to say Sierra, and I can argue against the other reasons later for other people, but most people have good picks, I think. But in terms of Legend, the reason why I say them is because they consistently had very high-quality games, like Deathgate, which Pascal's holding up, like Spellcasting Series, like Superhero League of Hoboken, actually, maybe not Superhero League of Hoboken, like Shannara, the Coles did, like Callahan's Cross Time Saloon, which somebody on this chat did. And then even after they went, they were forced to go make non-adventure games. They made Unreal, they made Star Control 3, and then they basically got out. So they stayed with their high-quality output basically the whole way. So that's why they're one of my picks. I mean, they almost didn't do anything wrong the whole way through, and that's a lot due to Bob Bates and Mike Verdue and all the other folks that were there, obviously, you know, the developers, Steve Moretzky and Glenn Dahlgren and Mr. Josh Mandel, of course. So, and the Coles. So it was a great company. The other company I want to mention, which I don't think anybody did, which is more of a dark horse in my mind, is Interplay. Because Interplay, I want to say more as a developer than a publisher, they were almost consistently high quality also. Brian Fargo had really a good eye for what to publish, both in the U.S. and stuff from overseas, like the Delphi and software stuff. And just, if you look at their track record overall, starting from the stuff that they developed and published, like the Bard's Tale series, like Mind Shadow, Bard, all the way going to the Bard's
Gate, Black. Yeah, before the Gold Box games came out with the AD&D, I would agree with you, Stuart, that Bard's Tale, you know, was of high quality, and that was pretty much the closest thing we had in the AD&D Gold Box games at the time. So I would definitely put something in your tip jar for Interplay.
We sadly seem to have lost Stuart at the moment, which means we're putting Josh back on the spot, I think. You were telling us about the King's Quest I VGA remake.
EGA.
Ah, EGA, my bad. Was it hell? Was it really terrible?
Josh, she's talking to you.
I'm sorry. I missed the first part cut out. What was the question?
We've lost Stuart for the moment, so you're back on the spot, I'm afraid. When you cut out, you were telling us about the King's Quest I remake.
Right. All right, and you can hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. King's Quest I remake... It was not terrible at all. We had a couple of programmers assigned to it, Randy and Gary, and I think they were sort of tired of working on it, but they had a good attitude. They came up with a vertical room change, a vertical scrolling room change that no one had done before. We used that for the Beanstalk, and no other game had that. They also came up with the horizontal scrolling. I think that King's Quest was the first one to have it, and then all the other games wanted it. But in the artwork, we made all of the rooms, or as many as possible, contiguous, so that when you got the scrolling room change, it would actually look decent. Roberta was excellent to work with, because I said to her, look, the text in the original King's Quest was really, really sparse, and it didn't really come across like you were being told or being involved in a fairy tale. It was very utilitarian. Would you mind if I just punched it up a little? And she said, sure, go for it. Anything you want, just run it by me first. And I changed every word of it. I only remember her taking out or changing either one or two things that I wrote. Everything else she left in place. She was very flexible. I think she was probably distracted because she was really, really cranking on King's Quest V at the time. But no, I thought it was a very pleasant experience, and it was. A very good introduction to the way that they did things at Sierra. So it served a good purpose for me as well.
As you mentioned King's Quest V, you did some voice acting for the CD version, as I recall.
Well, I did some voices for it. I don't know if you would call it acting.
I don't think it was that bad. I think the writing was terrible, but the acting was not bad. I hate to say it.
Well, the acting was, and I've said this before, so I don't feel the proper amount of shame saying it again. The problem was that I came from a classically trained acting background, and that was not what Roberta and Mark Siebert really wanted. They wanted something that was a lot more like a cartoon character, and they would say to me over and over, as I would try to bring some variation, bring him him down so that he wasn't always like this. I tried to make him a little more realistic and sometimes tired and sometimes angry and so on. And they had to keep telling me, no, no, bad Josh. King Graham is always buff. He is never tired. He is never angry. He's never upset. He is never anything but buff. So that's the way it all came out. And, you know, Richard Aronson, who played Cedric, and I laughed for many years about the way the voice acting went in King's Quest V.
That's very much the opposite to the way people kind of have expectations of voice acting now. But you've got a cult following because you've reprised that role several times, haven't you?
Right. Yes, in some of the remakes, also in like I think King's Quest VI, I may have done a few lines. I don't know, but yeah, it's kind of funny. I think more people know me as the voice of King Graham than know me for anything else I've done in my career. And because I am not particularly proud of that work, it is a little bit unsettling.
But how did that happen? I mean, how did they choose you? Was it normal that Sierra employees were casting for voices, or how did that happen?
Yes, back then we didn't really have the budget to hire professional actors. We didn't have a professional studio. We only had our little music studio that we rigged up to do voices, and I think the only voices probably we had recorded prior to King's Quest V were the voices for Jones in the Fast Lane, which we had also done video capture for of some of us talking and walking and things like that. I want to say this is a little bit off topic, but I love this story. On King's Quest I, one of the scenes I was rewriting was the very final scene where I think his name was King Edward, where King Edward dies, and that was like the last scene. In fact, I think if you play the very original King's Quest, he like dies on the floor, and you sit in the throne, and then the credits roll. It's really cut and dry. So I wanted to make it a little more interesting. And King's Quest IV, at the time that I was working on King's Quest I, King's Quest IV was the game that had most recently come out in the series, and the magic mirror played a really big part in King's Quest IV, and that's one of the treasures that you have to find in King's Quest I, and so you return to King Edward with the mirror and the chest and so on, all the treasures that you found. And so with King Edward's dying breath in the version I wrote that Roberta made me take out, I had King Edward say, "I think the mirror should go over there on that wall," and then he dies. And Roberta said, "I think if he's dying, his final words are not going to be interior decorating tips."
And, right, last words.
And I said, He doesn't know that's going to be his final words. You know, you don't know that kind of thing. But you know, I couldn't really defend it. She had been so gracious about all the other changes, and I knew when I wrote it that it was really a long shot anyway. But it was fun.
I love those stories. I love hearing those insider tales from now. What year was this? What year are we talking?
This would have been 1990.
1990, yeah.
Yeah.
Very, very cool.
That is extremely cool. What was the first project you actually got your full creative claws on, as it were? What point did you move from sort of production to having a greater influence on design or co-designing titles?
On design, it would probably be Freddy Farkas. There were a lot of little tidbits I had done, like on Space Quest IV, like the bargain bin box in Space Quest IV, and some other scenes in that game. But that was not design. That was just writing. It would have been Freddy Farkas, and also a little bit on Lorbo II, Dagger of Amun-Ra. Now that was very fundamentally a Bruce Balfour game, not a Roberta game.
I did adore that game.
There it is. Oh, we had so much fun working on that game. Bruce and Lorelei Shannon and myself, and maybe to a lesser extent, I think Jane may have had something, some input on that game. But, you know, Bruce was so ready to let us do anything kooky and morbid. So he had the right staff working.
The Walking Meat was amazing. I have no idea who might have been responsible for that, but I loved The Walking Meat.
I think that was probably Lorelei. But what had happened originally was that way back, and now I'm talking very end of 1990, maybe beginning of 91, Roberta had asked me to do Dagger of Amun-Ra because, well, at the time it wasn't Dagger of Amun-Ra, it was just, you know, Lorbo 2, whatever it's going to be, because we had had such a good experience working together on King's Quest. I knew that I wasn't the right person to work on Dagger of Amun-Ra because I had no experience with murder mysteries. And Bruce was already working for the company, and Bruce did have experience on them. But I had gotten as far as writing a story brief for the second Laura Bow. It was like maybe half a page about the setting and the murder and the whole framing. So I wrote that, and that's what Bruce got from Roberta. Roberta said, here, this is what we want. Josh has already written this. This is the story we want. But, you know, it required a ton of expansion and fleshing out, and that's all stuff that Bruce did. And I thought he did a fabulous job with it, much better than I ever could have done or imagined.
Wow, you look so young in the picture that Pascal has up. Were any of us ever that young?
Oh my god. Is that from Police Quest?
It is.
Leah Corona from Police Quest 3.
Yeah. It's really, you know, I don't think of myself any differently than 25 years ago when I was there and working, but there were so many wonderful people my age or even younger than me who were at Sierra who have since died. And it really makes me think about, gee, I've really gotten a hell of a lot older, more so than I think.
Well, that was a sober note.
I'm sorry. I dragged everything down. What a mistake.
We were just on Mars, so, you know. Mortality at least isn't as untimely as most of the things that happened in the Dagger of Amun-Ra, which was notoriously difficult.
Right.
What was your favorite title that you were involved with while you were at Sierra?
Oh, I think that would be Freddy Farkas. I put so much work into that, and the team that we had on that was so close. We went skydiving together. We went to a dude ranch together.
This isn't another like depressing story, is it?
No, I don't have anything depressing about this part of the.
Everybody in the skydiving turned out okay?
Yes.
All right, just making sure.
Yes. The people who went, not everybody went. Al did not go, for instance. But no, it was a very tight-knit group. We worked crazy hours. The programmers did a lot of things that at the beginning of development they were sure we would never be able to do. They never thought they would be able to synchronize a bouncing ball on screen with Sound Blaster music, for instance, for the ballads at the beginning and the end, the bouncing ball. The workbench in Freddy's pharmacy and back, with all the little bottles you could take and move around, that required so much memory, so much more memory than any Sierra game had ever required, that that room was crashing right up until the last day or so of development. You know, they did amazing things. The artwork, that main street scroller that Brandon knows, I keep trying to find some way to either get to him or digitize. You know, that was a beautiful, immense piece of artwork, much bigger than anything Sierra had ever done. The talkers that Ruben Huante did for that game, some of them, they looked like they were straight out of Don Martin and Mad Magazine. They were so cool. Just and most of all, I think, and working with Al, which was easy and fun, and we saw eye to eye on a lot more than we disagreed on. And then the culmination was when I was standing on this little second floor ledge overlooking the production area, and I was seeing the boxes being packed and then shrink-wrapped and being put in these cartons. And it was such a mixture of relief and total dread, because I thought, wow, a week from now there are going to be people out there on CompuServe and elsewhere playing this game, and is it going to crash for everyone? Are they going to loathe it? Are they going to say it was a waste of money? Was this a year and a half of my life wasted? It was just the most amazing moment, and I've never really felt that kind of intensity on any other project that I've worked on. So, yeah, Freddy.
In the end, Freddy Farkas was actually, well, I can only speak for the UK and Greek magazines, but it was incredibly well received in Europe, as I recall. I assume that was kind of the same Americans. Was that the case for you guys too?
I remember it getting good reviews. Computer Game World and I guess PC Gamer. I don't remember, but anyway, I remember it being well received.
Computer Gaming World really liked it a lot. That was Charles Ardai, who wrote that review, and I was so glad because he had always been my favorite reviewer in that magazine, and he really liked it. He gave it like either 4 or 4.5 stars, and years and years later, I guess it would have been 4 or 5 years later, when Callahan's Crosstime Saloon came out, he reviewed that, and he said, "This is the funniest game since Freddy Farkas' Frontier Pharmacist," and I was like, "Oh my God, I win."
He really likes you.
But the reception was good, but it was not great. It was at least a year before it sold enough copies to even justify doing a CD-ROM version. So, it did not sell big numbers right away, but it sold steadily. Westerns were never perceived as a genre that people were dying to see turned into an adventure game. So it was kind of a risk on that count, I guess.
Since you mentioned it, I suppose this would be an obvious time to cast a thought on Callahan's and your other work with Legend. Would you mind?
Not at all. Because I have to agree with Stuart that Legend is one of the best computer game companies there ever was. And that was because of Bob Bates and Mike Verdu, whose design sensibilities were so advanced from anything that Sierra had done. I think I learned more in the year or so that I worked at Legend than in the 4 or 5 years I worked at Sierra, just about what makes for good design. They originally had asked me to do a game based on David Edding's Belgariad. And that wasn't really my genre, but I read all the books at the time that were in the Belgariad series. And I developed a design proposal that was fairly detailed. And they took it to Edding's, and he didn't even read it. He said, he was already pretty old at the time, and he said, I don't want teenagers running around my universe killing each other and shooting and stabbing.
So disappointed by me, because I was exactly that sort of teenager when I got into his universe. I'm glad I knew nothing about the author, because I was disappointed in his work later. But the Belgariad was magical for me. Legend was kind of known for those those book licenses, though.
Yes, pretty much entirely at that point, except for what Steve Moretzky was doing for Legend, because he was doing things like the spellcasting series.
The Unready.
Right.
Well,
Eric was right. That was original. That was Bob's idea, and Mission Critical as well. That was Mike's. So they said to me, if you could choose any two writers, to once David Eddings had passed on the Belgariad. See, he only knew from Nintendo. So when they said they were going to make a computer game based on his world, I guess he sort of envisioned Metroid or something. They said any two writers who actively are being published. I said Spider Robinson and Dean Koontz. And they said, well, we have ties that can get us in with Spider Robinson. And he was interested, and I was thrilled because I adored the books. I threw myself into that game like I had in Freddy, and I was in a deep, deep depression at the time, and I set myself up in my home with a sky chair, which is like a big hanging chair, hangs from the ceiling like a sling, and I would sit in that sling for 12 hours at a pop. Just writing that game, and it's the one that's closest to my heart in terms of the sense of humor. It's a lot closer to my preferred sense of humor than Freddy was, frankly. Freddy was a little too scatological for me, but I loved working on Callahan's, and I was pretty happy with the outcome.
It's so one of those titles.
Out of curiosity, like game developers around like Sierra offices and stuff, what games did they play in their spare time, if they had any?
Oh, yeah. There was a lot of Doom. They played a lot of Doom. There was a lot of network, you know, they played a lot of network first-person shooters. So they didn't play Sierra games, that's for sure. They even some of them played Lucas games. I played Lucas games.
What?
Yeah, it's true. They always
kind
of
know the enemy.
Well, I don't think we ever really thought of them as the enemy, because we were turning out a different product from them. They were turning out these games at a very leisurely pace. And they didn't have to worry about budgets, and they certainly didn't have to worry about recording studios or voice talent. They were turning out these sort of Cadillac games, and we were turning out a much greater quantity of games. We were feeding the beast. Adventure gamers would have starved on a diet of Lucas games but they were good quality. Sierra's games were not as tightly designed, were not as tightly programmed, and so on. But we kept them coming at a time when people had a voracious appetite for.
You really got your money's worth as well. I mean, completing most Sierra games was a significant chunk of time. Even if you sat down every evening to do it, that was actually my family hobby. We'd sit down with my mum was a programmer, and she got me into computing partly by the use of adventure games. And we would sit down and we would play our way through Sierra games. And they lasted. King's Quest V was particularly brutal in that respect, as I recall. But Dagger of Amun-Ra, for example, with its incredibly hard ending, you had that level of challenge that I think is kind of representative of old games, that particularly those that predate internet solutions.
Right.
Because now you've got an expectation there'll be a hint button in a game to help you through, and because games are a little bit cheaper relative to income, I think.
Right.
They can be shorter. On the subject of modern games, you've recently worked with Al Lowe on the Larry Reloaded to some extent, didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't have to tell us if you don't want to.
I worked really hard on that game. Al and I had a really good time on it together. We had fun recording the voices. Everything else about it was a living nightmare. And I think it will be a long time before I do a Kickstarter again. Just doing the Kickstarter was it really takes it out of you. I don't know if any of you have participated in a Kickstarter, but it's like around the clock servicing. There were other problems that have been fairly well publicized about the people behind the scenes of the Larry remake. And I do not want to rehash it here, mostly because I'll start getting vicious emails. So I'm gonna bunt on this one.
Yeah, and not only about the Larry Reloaded. No, what I really mad about is the Fester Mutt thing, because after Larry Reloaded, you worked on Fester Mutt, and I really enjoyed that game a lot. It was an episodic title. I don't like episodic titles for one reason, and this is the one which happened. Sometimes the story won't continue. No, there will be no chapter 2, I guess, and that's really a terrible thing, because I enjoyed it a lot. It was a nice homage to the old games. Nice old school graphics, cool riddles and puzzles, some really challenging ones, and yeah, but sadly, as we know, there won't be an episode 2, I guess.
Well, there might be, because the developers, I mean, they have an episode 2. It's a matter of getting the money together and finding a publisher to do it. But they want to do it. We're still in touch. Every few months we talk. I ask them if they've gotten any closer to finding a publisher, and they say no. It's not going to happen soon, but, you know, the will is still there. We just need to find a way.
Oh, that's cool. Fingers crossed, and I guess nice.
You kind of, I guess, saw the sort of rise and fall and flatline and sort of the inklings of the re-rise of adventure games, I guess. What was the perspective on that? So from inside the industry, because from outside, I mean, it was before I got into journalism or anything, but the media were clanging the bell of doom long before the gamers I knew were, and I think that kind of had a negative impact on the genre as a whole. I mean, the fact that including those who, especially those who made a living from writing, liked shooting each other in the head in Doom, probably didn't help, but. What did it look like from the inside?
At the time, I found it very depressing and sad to watch. And in the intervening years, I've come to feel that the death of the adventure game, which I guess wasn't really a death, it was more like a coma, was the moment that the board of directors at Sierra Online said to Ken, "We no longer trust you. We're bringing in other people to run the company." I think that single decision is what really caused the downfall of adventure games for so long, because Sierra sort of represented the Sierra was the protector of the adventure game. Sierra kept adventure games flowing when no one else was keeping them flowing. They appealed to traditional gamers, and as soon as the board of directors made that decision, suddenly Sierra was no longer about the games. It was about the money. And while that had always been a factor at Sierra, it was never the overriding factor. And then all of a sudden, one day, it was the overriding factor. And the kind of games we did went out the window, and suddenly the what we considered decent sales of a game, maybe 200,000 units to 500,000 units, suddenly that was nowhere near what they wanted. They wanted numbers like Myst. So they wanted millions and millions of units sold. And, you know, it was impossible for Sierra to keep doing what it was best at doing and make those kinds of numbers. And since they were the last real guardians of the adventure game, once they fell, the whole genre fell. So that's my perspective now. Back then, it was terrifying and upsetting, and I couldn't really be a part of what was happening at Sierra anymore, because it wasn't what had made the company so great in the first place. That sort of aesthetic was no longer valued there, and it was a huge shame. So now I've put a downer on the conversation once more.
It's okay. We've got
movies and games have almost a parallel situation, because what ends up happening in film is you'll have a Titanic, right, or even better example would be Avatar, which makes like $2.5 billion. All of a sudden, the top brass in Hollywood will only accept movies that make $2.5 billion. So it's almost like this graduating scale of success. And what no one realizes is if you make a movie that, or a game, because we're talking about games here, but if you make a movie that's $10 million budget and you make $100 million on it, you made a huge profit. You know, I don't know why Hollywood never figures that out, but gaming is sort of the same situation where I don't think Myst had a very big production budget, because there's only two guys that made that game, as I recall, and they sold millions and millions of units, so they had a huge profit margin. Well, if you keep the budget low and sell 200,000 units, you can make a decent amount of money making games, but all of a sudden the level for success is set way too high, you know. And
right, right.
I don't know why that's such a thing, but it just happens.
I think that's changing somewhat. I mean, that's kind of the more optimistic note. That's changing somewhat with the current sort of crop of smaller companies doing smaller things. You're nodding there really enthusiastically, Josh.
Yes, yes. Yeah, that's the resurgence. It's the resurgence of the creativity and the willingness of some publishers to accept the kind of arrangement that we're talking about, where, yes, you don't sell that many games, but your expenses are low, So you end up making a really nice profit anyway. So it's very, it gives me cause for optimism where I had none for a lot of the last 20 years. So I am enthusiastic about it, yeah.
Were you still working for Sierra at the time when they were sold? I mean, they were sold in 96 or so. Ken left Sierra in 97. I guess your last projects were 95 with Space Quest 6 and other titles?
Yes, I left just before, in late 94.
Late 94, okay.
Yeah.
So you...
So they had not been sold yet, but they... You know, there was talk about it in the halls, and it was going to happen. It was just a matter of when, not if.
So I have to ask, have you seen much about the new King's Quest that's being made? And if so, what do you think of it?
I haven't seen any more than anyone else has seen. And I kind of like it. I have very mixed emotions about it, of course, because, you know, they're playing with canon and redefining things that had perfectly good definitions for a long time. So I have mixed emotions about it. The only interaction I've had with the Odd Gentleman was on Twitter. Someone said something like, because they had just announced the voice cast for the new King's Quest, and Christopher Lloyd is going to be the old King Graham, and I forget who they got for the young King Graham. Someone had posted something about, I guess if you can't get Josh Mandel, Chris Lloyd is, you know, an acceptable substitute, or something like that, which... you know, I laughed about a lot, and I said, I replied and said, hey, I've been put out to pasture by better men than Christopher Lloyd. Actually, I haven't. That's a lie. He's the best. And then the Odd Gentleman popped up and said something like, well, we have a few ideas how to honor your part in the King's Quest legacy. And... So my eyebrows are raised, but I'm going to have a hard time playing it, I think.
What do you play at the moment? If you're playing anything,
actually, lately, like for the last 6 months to a year, and I have a hard time admitting this, I've been playing a lot of hidden object games.
They're very soothing.
Well, no, not because they're soothing, but because I really, really, really want to do a parody of hidden object games. They're all so identical. They're all female detective is called out in the middle of a rainy night to a broken down asylum / cemetery.
Totally sensible places.
I'm sorry, what?
Totally sensible places to go on a rainy night.
Yes. Oh, yeah, of course. And they always wreck their car right at the fence, right at the front gate, so that you have to, you know, go into your glove compartment, your glove box, to find important things. I so want to do a parody of these games, so I've been playing them and making notes about ways I would like to twist them into obscene and unexpected ways.
Play that.
Good. I gotta design it.
And well, and sort of more on sort of more career, what a career wide focus. excuse me. Across the gaming industry, sort of. I guess, what are your big influences, not only in gaming, but also I know other media tend to feed into a lot of game developers. So, yeah, what are your influences, just generally speaking? What do you love?
My biggest influence in everything I write, whether I'm aware of it or not, turns out to be Mad Magazine. I read so much Mad Magazine when I was a kid. They were really instrumental in developing my sense of humor. And even now when I write things, there are little references, there is a rhythm, there is just a sensibility that is like right out of the pages of Mad, say, 1955 to 1970, maybe. So that was my biggest influence, and other comedians mostly as well, people whose names you may very well never have heard, Stan Freberg, Bob and Ray, Mike Nichols and Elaine May, Bob Newhart, you know, a lot of these comics were people that I listened to incessantly when I was a kid and when I was a teenager, and right up until the time I started doing comedy myself and didn't have time to listen to much of anything anymore. And all those flavors still come out in everything I write, plus a little bit of Spider Robinson.
Go ahead, Pascal.
Yeah, I would really like to know what is someone like Josh Mandel doing today? So what are you doing for a living? Do you still need to do something for a living because you earned millions and billions out of King's Quest V voice acting career and stuff? But are you still... do anything, I guess it's just for a hobby that you have to do something and your wife doesn't get bored by you or something like that, but... What is it? Is it gaming? Are you involved in that, or what is it? Any projects you're working on, top secret and stuff like that?
I just want to make it clear, I was never a contract designer for Sierra. It was the contract designers who were able to build houses on the strength of their royalties, to buy cars, that kind of thing. I was paid a salary. And so once the game hit the stands, I saw no money from any game I've ever worked on. So I do still work. My wife, fortunately, has a very good job, so there is not a lot of pressure on me to work, but I like to work. Right now, I am editing and rewriting dialogue for an upcoming mobile CRPG called Ember that's coming from a company called Enfusion. They're the developer. I worked with them on Larry, the Larry Reloaded remake. I've worked with them on a lot of games in the last, 12, 15 years. So now they have this great game coming out, and they wrote volumes and volumes of placeholder text. So I'm going through it and actually trying to give the characters some differentiation, some humor, but not too much. So I'm doing that. I'm also getting a new business up and running, because ever since I was 11 years old, I've twisted balloons, and I really enjoy it. I know this sounds really off the wall, but I'm starting a balloon twisting business later this year. And so I'm practicing that. In fact, for I think it was this website Adventure Gamers, in my Christmas video, they assemble a Christmas video every year, I think I twisted Rosella and the whale's tongue. So if you go to Adventure Gamers and you look up their 2014 Christmas video, you can see me twisting a balloon version of Rosella and a balloon version of the whale tongue and trying to get her to climb up it and stay, and she keeps falling off of it. So, yes, there's this whole unexplored area that is the intersection of computer adventure games and balloon twisting, and I am going to make millions of dollars exploiting that underserved niche.
That's what they say about finding your niche. Do you still do stand-up?
No. No. My partner, I loved doing stand-up with my partner, and once she quit to have babies, I never... I tried it again a few times, and it just wasn't nearly as enjoyable for me. In fact, one of the final shows that I ever did with her was at the 1990 Christmas party at Sierra Online. They flew my partner out to California so that we could entertain at the Christmas party. I don't know what they were expecting, but I think they got something other than what they were expecting. But it was great because Ken approached me right after we got off stage, and he said, "You're an entertaining kind of guy. You should be designing these games." And I said, yeah. So I don't do stand-up anymore, but I still write a lot of comedy.
Is there sound if I do screen sharing? Because I have this Christmas video here.
As far as I know, you don't get sound, but Brandon's got some balloon action going on his screen as well. So we're all really excited. We really wish you brought some balloons at this point. I hope you understand this. You don't happen to have one.
All right, the next hangout, you let me know when it's going to be, and I will come prepared with some balloons.
Thank you.
Okay, so here in the video, clearly, I am just... Oh, there's the tongue. I got the whale
goodness,
tongue there.
That's not like a little
that's
thing.
That's not just my head.
Oh, you thought I was talking about some tiny little thing. No, this is serious whale tongue here.
Yeah, that's the real deal right there. You're not messing around.
Brandon? I think the whale tongue got him.
Yes, the whale tongue got me.
Oh, well. You
play? Yes.
Oh, there it is.
I'm not sure we get to see Rosella or not here.
Oh, yeah. Yep, here she comes.
There we go.
Is this
nowhere else
scale?
On the internet? I mean, nowhere else on the internet can you... I mean, Big Box PC Gamers is where it's at to get live commentary on whale tongue and Rosella action. We have made it, folks. Words.
Whale tongue
girl on tongue action, yeah.
No,
they're not to scale. If they were to scale there she goes. The tongue would have been a lot larger, or she would have been a lot smaller, but I just didn't want to spend that many balloons on a whale tongue for one video.
Have you already shared your business plan with someone else than your wife?
With a few people, yeah. I mean, I have temporary business cards. My final logo is actually being done by Rich Powell, who used to be at Sierra and whose artwork now has been in Mad Magazine in the last... in the last few years. So he's doing my logo. It's not finished yet. I've already done some jobs. None of them have tied into adventure games yet, but it's coming. I know it's coming.
Nice.
Through the benefit of your experience, and I know the industry's changed now relative to then, but on the other hand, you've got to experience Kickstarter joy. What guidance would you give to people looking to get into the glamorous and highly paid world of adventure game development? I'm sorry, I cracked me up.
Yeah. I would say take theater classes because a game designer, especially an adventure game designer, is in essence a playwright and a director. And you have to have those skills, especially if you want to do something that is either a comedy or a serious drama. You have to know blocking. You have to know timing. These are all very theatrical skills. And I certainly found that theater training served me really well in my time in the industry. So even if you're not interested in in a broader sense, just in terms of learning a few things that are going to be valuable when you craft an adventure game. It's a fantastic resource and something everyone should try.
That's actually not something I'd heard before, but that does make a great deal of sense.
Yeah, it really illuminates, like, you know, I don't want to get political or anything, but public schools, especially in the United States, I don't know if it's the same way in Europe, but are like hacking and slashing theater classes, you know, art education, and all these things that on the surface no one thinks are useful. But, you know, on the underpinnings, these are all extremely useful skills for professionals in the real world.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, and having some background in art, for me, that would have been very valuable. I didn't have much of a background in drawing or painting or anything like that. Composition, things like that, that would have been a great asset. And the same thing with music as well. You know, I had to put a lot of trust in the composers that I worked with all throughout my career, because I did not have the knowledge that would have helped me. So, you know, I had the theater training, but more background in art and music would have helped a great deal. So you're right.
Let's just come up in the sidebar, because Pascal is a great fan of Spy versus Spy, and who wouldn't be? Did you have a particular favorite Mad strip or artist?
Well, I think my favorite artist probably would have been Jack Davis. He did so many covers, so many parodies, and Mort Drucker was also a real favorite. I tended not to care that much about Don Martin, David Berg, a little bit, but I think Jack Davis was my favorite. And as far as the writers go, Howard Kurtzman, probably someone I look up to greatly, and he did a lot of things other than Mad Magazine, so he was terrific. I particularly liked the A Mad Look Behind the Scenes At, and I'm sure Brandon probably knows about this, but for Eric, I wrote a Mad Peek Behind the Scenes at Sierra Online, which is still waiting to see print, but it was pretty detailed, and I had a lot of fun writing it, and I'm having a lot of fun envisioning what it will eventually turn out as under Eric's supervision.
Brandon's sitting there nodding sagely, and I'm kind of hoping he might have some insider knowledge on the sort of various history Sierra history related projects going on that might touch on your own your work, Josh. Brandon, got anything?
I don't have a lot, but seems like a good segue just to hold up a little something that is here at the Sierra Museum, which is kind of our ongoing effort we kind of realized that working on the Art of Sierra book was kind of going to be one stage of a larger preservation effort that we thought was important. And so this is just a few of the materials that we have here, and Josh has very graciously sent us a lot of great materials for us to have in our permanent collection. And so here's some of the Freddy sheets the animation sheets that we have. So I thought you guys would enjoy seeing those.
So many frames.
Many, many, many frames. Yeah, all drawn, photocopied, colored, and there's pages and pages of just Freddy alone. Here's some.
I like that. There's enough pages for all of us. That is nice.
Part of the thing was that Freddy had to wear different outfits, so that's why there's so many pages of Freddy Walkers.
Nice.
That's all I got at the moment.
Great.
Thank you.
Nice.
Well, it's 5:40. This is probably a good spot to cut the broadcast, and then we can go on with our after show where things get rowdy.
I have one critical question.
Oh, go for it. Yeah, of course.
Cedric!
That bloody owl. Since we are the big BBPC gamers, I'd really like to know what Josh's favorite big boxes are, separating both those that he obviously feels very personally about, like that but also, your favorite box that had to do with your work and your favorite big box that you've ever seen.
I love the Freddy Farkas box with the fake leather, tooled leather border legs. I thought that was a wonderful box. Unfortunately, it's apparently better known now than it used to be that if you want to sell a lot of copies, you do not use brown on your box. And there, oh, thank you, Pascal. So that was a heavily brown box, and But I love that box. I also, frankly, love the art for the Callahan's box, but that predated the game. That wasn't done especially for the game, really, except for the logo. So, that artwork for the Callahan's box was actually done by a cousin of Andy Warhol. But I think my favorite PC game, and I do not have the box handy, I think I still have it, I think it survived the flood, we had a flood here a few years ago, was Planetfall by Steve Moretzky. Certainly not a huge seller.
Lost him again.
I think we have. But we got our
Planetfall is a classic Infocom game. David, didn't you finish that game? Have you played that one?
No, I haven't finished. I sat down and played it, but I never finished it. I could probably do it, but I never got around to finishing it. Not because I didn't know how, but just time investment.
Josh went muted. But I think we covered most of the bases there. Joel, anything to wrap up?
No, I think that's it. If you're watching and not a member of the Facebook group, hit us up on the Facebook. We're Big Box PC Game Collectors group, and we have a lot of fun in there. If you're a lover of old PC games, stop by and have a chat. I think we'll wrap it there and start the after party. So thank you, everyone. I'm going to switch to Pascal real quick to show that Planetfall box. And we'll see you guys. We'll see you on the other side. Goodbye and good luck.